My name is Marta Maguera, and I'm a security tester in PCR team in Milestone Systems. And today I will talk about how to make integration secure. But before I do that, let me tell you what Product Security Incidents Team is all about. As the name suggests, our main responsibility is to respond to the incidents. Meaning, when we get a reported vulnerability, we investigate it to see whether the threat is a theoretical one or an actual one, and based on the evaluation, we fix it either ourselves or with the aid of a feature team. But that's not the only thing we do. We also try to put attackers' shoes on, trying to find vulnerabilities and different attack vectors in our software. We also try to aid feature teams whenever they have any security-related questions and uncertainties. So now that you know what we're all about, let's go to the security principle topic. This is something you should always have in mind when designing a secure software. There's quite a lot of the principles, so I will go one by one and explain what they mean. The first one is called economy of mechanism, meaning the more complex your program is, the harder it is to understand it, the harder it is to secure it, and the harder it is to fix it when the vulnerability is found. There's this KISS principle, keep it simple, silly, meaning the more complex your program is, the more opportunities for something to go wrong. Imagine if you wrote a code that's 4 lines of code, and the probability of having a buffer overflow there is smaller than when your program is 2 million lines of code, because there is just way more things that can go wrong. The next principle is called the least common mechanism. And that one talks about that sharing should be minimized, meaning that sharing resources provides a channel along which information can be transmitted. If one program can corrupt the shared state, it can then corrupt other programs that depend on it. The good example is Hopwood interface attack, which combined a bug in Java interface mechanism with a shared public variable that ultimately broke the type system and thus circumvented the system security. But when talking about least common mechanism, we should remember about the next principle, leverage existing components, because that one advocates for reusing the existing components because they are well tested, that reduces the attack surface, minimizes the numbers of vulnerabilities and overall risk, and it also reduces the development time, thus increasing the productivity. So a developer is at this point at the crossroad of what to choose, and he should base his choice based on risk when using a either-or principle, least common mechanism or leverage existing components. The next one is called least privilege, and it's pretty straightforward. You should just get enough authority to get the job done. A simple user should not run administrator privileges. Simple security guard looking at the screens of smart client should not be allowed to have admin rights and delete all the recordings. The next principle is called defense in depth, meaning that you should improve your security by providing layers of defense. And each additional layer should be different, because if an attacker attacks one layer and manages to penetrate it, he still has several other layers to go. But if all the layers are the same, then nothing stops in his way to just penetrating all of them in once. The next one is called fail-safe, and it talks about expecting and planning for failure, meaning you should fail to safe state, but secure state. Imagine you are in the elevator and there's a power outage. You do not want your elevator to fall down to the bottom because there's no more power. You want the elevator to stop where it is and wait for the power to come back or a rescue team to get you out. When talking about fail-safe, we need to distinguish between fail-safe and fail-safe securely. Take automatic doors example. If an automatic door has power taken away, in a fail-safe scenario, the doors will be unlocked so everybody can go in and out. If doors fail safe securely, the doors will remain closed until the power is restored. And that leads us to the term explicit deniability, meaning that if it's not specially authorized, everything should be denied by default, because doing the opposite is risky. You might not think about all the reasons why you should deny the access. The next principle is called complete mediation. Every time when it's possible, we should check for access. Imagine you're standing in front of Milestone systems and you're having an access card. You swipe the card, you go to the main lobby, and then you have next doors. You should again swipe your card and then get your access check whether you're allowed to proceed further or not. Because just because you're a guest in Milestone doesn't mean you should be allowed into the server room. The next principle is called separation of duties, meaning one person should not be responsible for only one thing. If, for example, I, as a worker in Milestone, request for a company car that is a Ferrari, I should not be the one that approves the purchase, because I am pretty sure Milestone does not want to have a Ferrari for me as a company car. The next principle is called open design, meaning that the secrecy of mechanism should not be dependent on the secrecy of design or implementation. It should not be about the secrecy of the algorithm. Rather, it should be about the secrecy of the key. Everybody should be able to read the algorithm, and the secrets will stay secret. The most important and interesting principle, I think, is psychological acceptability, meaning that the security mechanism should not make it more difficult to access the resource, and it should be either transparent or introduce only minimal obstruction to the user. Because our main enemy is a human. We are lazy. We do not want to click through gazillions pop-up to get to something we want. And if it's made too hard, we will just disable the security. And then what's the use of having a security at all? The last principle is called good enough security, meaning there is a constant trade-off between implementing a security features and other features in the software. And does it make sense to implement a state-of-the-art security system for something that's not worth securing at all? So we've covered quite a lot of principles now. And I've written a short summary here so you can have a short overview of what we have talked about. So to remind you again, economy of mechanism means you should keep it simple. Least common mechanism means you should avoid sharing, but leverage existing components advocates for reusing secure components. Least privilege means you should only allow minimum, defense in depth, have a multiple layers of security, fail-safe, prepare for failure, complete mediation, check every access, separation of duties, you should have separate checks, open design, you should avoid security through obscurity, psychological acceptability, the protection should be easy to use, and good enough security means that you should have appropriate levels of security. Let's move on to the next topic, tools. There are several tools that can help you in making your product secure. There are a couple techniques that I will talk about and I encourage you to try them out. The first one is called threat modeling. And threat modeling is a process where you can identify the threats, enumerate them, and then find mitigations and prioritize them. And there are many good reasons why you should threat model. You can find the bugs early. And remember, redesign and refactor, it takes quite a long time if it's done in later stages of software development. It helps you understand the security requirements because threats do not line up sometimes with requirements and they might not be worth addressing. Or some other threats might be too expensive to be addressed and you want to address them only partially or not address them at all. It helps you engineer and deliver better product. Nobody wants to deliver a product and right after release have a constant stream of security bugs, because this is not good for the image of the company and it's also not good for you, your feelings. Also, it helps you address issues that other techniques won't. For example, failure to authenticate connection will not be found by the code analysis tool. The next technique is called security review. It allows you to find the vulnerabilities in places that the other techniques haven't. For example, it helps you identify the weak security controls that might take long periods of tedious dynamic testing. For example, if an application uses a blacklist to prevent the SQL injection, this can be readily identified in a code review. But it may take quite a long time to identify the same issue via dynamic testing, depending on how good your blacklist is. There are a couple best practices to follow. You should create a code review checklist to follow a simple, comprehensive methodology. Categorize vulnerabilities according to risk to be able to address the most important one first. Use a combination of manual and automatic approaches. The reason is they both have advantages and disadvantages. For example, the manual helps you identify logical flaws or errors, especially in the design and architecture of an application. But it is time-consuming and it needs a highly knowledgeable expert in both the security and development aspects of software. The automatic security review, on the other hand, tests large chunks of code in a short period of time, which is quite crucial in our new world with Agile. It helps you detect security issues, for example, like data validation, but it might contain high level of false positives and it is quite expensive, especially for small companies. The next tool is called security testing. And similar to the previous two, it helps you find the issues that the other ones didn't. There are a couple of reasons to security test. It helps you reveal the vulnerabilities and show the real risk from the attacker point of view. Getting the feedback from the test will also tell you what actions can be taken to improve the defense. The last tool I want to talk about is security standards. And I'm not saying that you should go and get certified in all of them, but reading the security standards can give you an idea of what you can improve in your software. And here I have written a couple of security standards from NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technology, from United States Department of Commerce. And as I said, you don't have to certify in all of them. I would like to talk about one of the standards here, FIPS 140 series. Security requirements for cryptographic modules. And the reason I want to talk about is because in the recent months, Milestone decided to take a look at the standard and see whether we're following it or not, because it is required by the government agencies in the United States and Canada. And if they have FIPS flag enabled, the software should be able to run. So we decided to take a look how our software works and whether we follow the standard or not. FIPS 140-2 defines of levels of requirements for cryptographic modules. And cryptographic modules are defined as any combination of hardware, firmware of software that implements cryptographic functions, such as encryption, decryption, hashing, digital signatures, authentication techniques, and random number generation. It is divided into 11 functional areas that I have displayed on the screen, and each area is awarded the security level between 1 and 4 based on the requirement that it meets. So what does it mean for you as an integrator? Milestone tried their best to preserve backwards compatibility with the older versions, but that sometimes was not possible. So for example, the default value for DB exporter encryption strength has been changed from DAES 56 to AES 256. If you have a FIPS enabled system, the database exports will fail if they are using non-FIPS compliant encryption method. Also, loading the export from in database format will fail if they have been encrypted with a non-FIPS compliant encryption method. Access to licenses and feature flags through either Environment Manager System License or the License Manager classes from a pre-2020 R3 standalone or smart client integration toward a FIPS-enabled VMS will not work. If FIPS is not enabled on the server, the Axel will still work. On the FIPS-enabled system, pre-2020 R3 MIP SDK version of Media Provider Service will not work. Media Provider Service cannot also communicate with pre-2020 R3 MIP driver that is running on FIPS-enabled system. So in general, we strongly encourage everyone to upgrade their standalone integrations to use the 2020 R3 MIP SDK and to make sure that your integrations are FIPS compliant if you want to run in the FIPS compliant mode. There's also a couple other standards. Those written down here are from the ISO, International Organization for Standardization. And again, similarly to those from NIST, you don't have to certify in all of them. But I've written some of them that might give you an idea where to look and what to look for if you want to see if you follow any of the standards. I also written down a couple of the useful links that you might find useful for you if you try to do some integrations. Check out the hardening guide, which shows what are our recommendations, how to harden the system to run the best possible hardened system. Check out the certificate guide, where we tell you how to set up the certificate to work with our VMS. On the content portal, you can check out a couple articles regarding the MIP SDK. And the last one is MIP SDK documentation if you have any questions. Also, feel free to contact either me or anyone in Milestone, and we will be happy to reply to everything. Thank you for your for listening, and see you. Any question, write them in the chat box. Thank you.